Thank you. Thank you so much for coming. So we'll have to pick that bar that we go watch Hillary at as a group. So a couple things. Before we begin, I also want to thank Jen McCreary of the Citizen for putting this whole thing together and the rest of the Citizen team that's here. And I want to thank Barnes, Martha Lucy, and Tom Collins, the visionary behind all this. And they are doing some amazing stuff. This Sunday, they've got a gospel brunch, which I might just come and get my white man overbite on. Also partner Young Involved Philly, where's Nick? Nick Marzano, there he is. You had a great story slam last night at Johnny Brenda's. The Knight Foundation, there are a few institutions in Philadelphia doing more important civic work than the Knight Foundation. And the Tuttleman Foundation, is Max Tuttleman here? My brother from another mother? Not here. And finally, media partner WURD, who's broadcasting live, and Nick Taliaferro, if you haven't heard Nick on Afternoon Drive, yeah, John Fetterman's a fan. If you haven't heard Nick on Afternoon Drive, he is one of the most thoughtful voices in Philadelphia. And that may be admittedly a low bar, but he's a very thoughtful voice. And we're partnering, the Citizen has been partnering with Be Heard Philly, the survey research. So when we go up to the atrium, you'll be able to sign up to be part of the survey. We just want to understand what Philadelphia thinks about things, and not just do the daily stenography of who said what yesterday, but to explore ideas and solutions, and also to hear from people. So look for more polls. We've done a poll on poverty and a poll on the soda tax, and look for more of that, and we want you involved with that. We want your voice involved with that. So with that, let's begin. And let me say, well, I'll get to that in a second. Let me just give you a little background here. It's easy to get frustrated in this presidential political season, right? Because America's jumped the shark. There is proof positive that presidential politics is the place where ideas go to die. And so Nick asked me earlier, like, how do you keep from getting down? You keep from getting down because of people like these, who at the local level, cities across the country, have become laboratories of experimentation and innovation. And these three, and by the way, Svante Myrick, the mayor of Ithaca, sends his regrets. He had the opportunity to have an audience with Hillary, and obviously his priorities are way out of whack. So I'm so excited that we have these innovators with us. And let me just give you a brief summary of them. To my immediate right, and that's the only time he'll be on the right of anything, Alex Torpey, the former mayor of South Orange, New Jersey. May 2011, 23-year-old Alex Torpey became mayor of South Orange by a 14-vote margin. And he governed in a way that was consistently reimagining the relationship between citizens and their government. He's also has many entrepreneurial ventures going and is crisscrossing the nation right now for Run for America, recruiting young people to run for public office. Thank you for being here, Alex. Lovely Warren became mayor in Rochester January 1st, 2014. 2010, she was elected president of the Rochester City Council, the youngest in the city's history. She has pioneered education reform and an innovative program she calls a stairway out of poverty, worker-owned businesses in Rochester. Thank you so much for being here, Lovely. And I want to stress that she's got to get back to the convention floor and leave at 7:30. So when she gets up to go, don't take it personally.
That
way we were going to get to that, yes. That would be the first question. And finally, John Fetterman, well-known in this media market at this point, mayor of Braddock, Pennsylvania, recent U.S. Senate candidate. Alex, John thinks you were elected in a landslide because in 2005.
I was going to pull that one, but I'll let you have it. You know, you can tell him.
Stepping on your line.
Yeah, it really is stealing a bit of my thunder, but yes.
So I'll shut up at that point. But I will say that John holds a master's of public policy from Harvard, and what really strikes me about these three, and four had Savanti been able to make it, is they haven't waited for Superman. They haven't waited for the federal government. They haven't done things the usual way. And I want to get to their individual stories, but first let's begin with Lovely and what you did today. Can you share, some people have read about it already, but it's really lovely.
Well, yes. Well, actually, today we put a sign by Susie B. Anthony's gravesite. Susie B. Anthony is born or buried in Rochester, New York. And she, of course, I was elected 141 years to the day that she cast her illegal vote in Rochester and was arrested. And today I informed her that we actually have a woman that is running to be president on a major party ticket. And if it was not for her and her casting her illegal vote and fighting for women's rights, then I would not be where I'm at today and Hillary would not be where she's at today. So even on election, every election day in the city of Rochester, many women from around our area comes from all over to put their I voted today sticker on her grave to let her know that we are still thinking about her and we truly appreciate the sacrifices that she made as a woman fighting for women's rights. And, you know, so today we wanted to let her know that we truly appreciate that sacrifice. And I wrote a letter to her and encourage people to come by and write notes to her to tell her thank you. And they have. And, you know, really, really excited about that.
That's awesome.
Great.
So let's begin talking about the ways that you guys have figured out to get around the often insurmountable roadblocks that present when you are trying to achieve progress running a major city. Let's start with you, Mayor Fetterman. Tell us what Braddock Redux is and the rationale behind it.
Sure. Well, Braddock Redux is a 501c3, and that's IRS speak for a nonprofit. And early on, I believed that I was going to need an additional tool to facilitate development and different things in my community. Because for those of you that aren't familiar with my community, I'll briefly quickly go through it. Braddock is a steel town. Western Pennsylvania, the stereotypes were true, and the emphasis is were true in terms of steel there. And my community is historically significant because it's where Andrew Carnegie built his first steel mill. I mean, the richest man that ever lived started his fortune in my community. And you would drive through my community now, and it doesn't look like much, and it's hard to imagine, but it would be like going to San Francisco 100 years from now and seeing 90% of the people gone and talking about, well, Mark Zuckerberg started this thing called Facebook, you know, and things really took off. And it's my community is a lesson, among other things, on how quickly things can shift. Things that were once thought unthinkable can now become the reality. So I created the 501c3 simply to be a vehicle to do a lot of non-governmental functions that didn't neatly fit into government.
And that was a way to, because you didn't want to rely on the mayoral relationship with town council.
Yeah, originally, and he won by 14 votes, so I'm going to drop won my first election by one vote. And it it was actually a tie. And the then council president, we should have gotten our own sitcom. It was like we were like the odd couple, you know, like I'm the messy roommate and he was the neat one, and we just never got along. And he really tried hard to kind of torpedo things, so we just kind of, you know, were able to circumvent a lot of the the initial gridlock, and because we just really, I've never considered, nor do I still consider myself a politician. I'm a social worker that chose elective office to pursue the things that I care about. So,
that's awesome. Mayor Warren, you get elected, and I was looking at the numbers, the poverty numbers and the education numbers in your city, and it's incredibly daunting. But fascinatingly, it's not a money question. $26,000 per pupil was being spent, and you wanted to reform education. So like Mayor Fetterman, you did something out of the box. Right. Can you explain what your game plan?
So in Rochester, New York, Rochester, for those that don't know, my city, we're the third largest city in the state of New York. A population of about 210,000. We're situated between Buffalo and Syracuse. We are number one in the nation for childhood poverty for a city of our size. But the interesting thing is you can live in Rochester all your life and never see poverty because it is completely concentrated and basically in a moon-shaped crescent we can put around it. And the mayor does not control the school district in our community. And so our city, we have to contribute $119.1 million. That's about 68% of the taxes that we contribute automatically to our school district. However, we have no say as to what happens in our school district. When you're in a situation where everything impacts, you know, education impacts what we do around jobs, it impacts what happens around crime and other things, you try to figure out ways in which you can now help your children, help your families and your community when you don't have controls over the city school district. So I started a 3-to-3 initiative when I first came to office, pulling together parents and experts to talk about what are the things that we need to do in order to make sure that every child in our city has a fighting chance at life. And what we realize is that we need to have children at least enrolled in pre-K no later than 4 years old, but we would like to do that starting at age 3. And we pushed for many parents in our community to enroll their children in pre-K. Our pre-K 4 classes are, 98% filled, students going to school. And the governor was able to give us support for a pre-K 3, which kicked off this January. We also re-envisioned how we utilize our recreation center in our libraries. Those are under the city's control. And so we started to not just have recreation centers be about play, but we brought academic programs in there after school as well as during summer months to stop the summer learning loss. Our library started an aggressive literacy campaign. Working with our local school district, we were able to hire literacy aides during the school year, but also during the summertime to help our young people get the skills that they need to learn how to read, but to maintain those reading levels, because we know if children do not read by the age at grade level, by the third grade, that their academic success is significantly diminished. So utilizing tools that we currently have under our system in City Hall, we were able to really start the program of reimagining education for our students.
And just to emphasize this, what was critical, I imagine that most mayors would have sort of thrown up their hands at the tough issue of education because it's not your job. There's a school district that does that. But you decided to spend, this had to be spending some political capital because you looked into what you could control that is outside the purview of the school district. And I'm sure that wasn't met with hugs and kisses.
No, we still have challenges, and of course nobody, especially when you have an elected school system, you have a strong teachers union, they want control over the system. But at the end of the day, for me, it's the fact that I have a 6-year-old daughter. What I want for my child, I want for every child that's in my city, and I want them to be able to have a fighting chance at life. I want them to grow up knowing that they can achieve any dream that they, their hearts desire. And we have a small window of time. We only get one chance to educate a child. You can't do it over again. I'm an attorney by trade, so I was able to see, you know, firsthand the effects of the criminal justice system. When our educational system fails our children, then many of them are, you know, basically pipelined to the prison system. In order to stem that, we have to utilize every resource that we have available and in our control and not in our control to make sure that our children get what they need so that they can have a successful life.
That's terrific. Mayor Torpey, you're now retired at,
yes.
at the age of 28,
yes.
29. Yes, but you took office and with the goal of kind of returning the government to the citizen. Can you outline what you did along those lines to give the government back to the citizenship?
Sure. Well, you know, one of the things that we've talked a lot about before is, you know, is some of the digital work that we did to, like, put our budget online, for instance. And there were a lot of different tools that we made available so that people had better access to information. And when you think about that, there's a couple different ways that you can sort of slice. So, like, one of the things that we've talked a little bit about in the past is, you know, that we, you know, the state of New Jersey requires that municipal governments file their budgets. They're starting to redo it in the last year or two. Right after I left, of course. But, you know, I didn't get to take advantage of this. They required in this, like, really complicated PDF format. It's not machine readable. It's not sort. It's only got 2 years of budget data. It's very hard to understand. So if a citizen were to go online and look at what each municipal government is required to produce each year for their budget, it's not really something that you can understand and make any sense of as far as, like, I want to understand my city's budget. Right. So we were like, what I would love to see is what we look at, what my administration looks at, what our governing body looks at, what kind of budget information we have access to is what people who live in our community should have access to. So let's take that spreadsheet, the Excel spreadsheet that we use to play with all the numbers, let's put it up on the website, and let people play with the numbers the same way that we did. And we put it up there, and we saw within the first couple of days there were hundreds of downloads of the you know, Excel spreadsheet, and, you know, getting feedback from people like, oh, this is kind of fun. And I'm like, you have too much time on your hands. But the proposition was kind of twofold, right? One is there's a value to this transparency. And that if, you know, there are certain people who believe that in government, you know, what the government does should be seen by the people, regardless of whether people do see it or not, right? So that there's a value to putting that budget online, even if zero people look at it. And then there is the tool value of doing transparency. And what does that accomplish? Over the last couple of weeks here and in Cleveland, on TV, on the radio, on the internet, we have heard, I've heard the word trust thrown around so many times by everybody who's running for president. And they think about trust and they frame trust as like, I'm running for office and I want you to trust me. And that's still framed in trusting that one individual person. And what I wanted to do is say, well, it's not about me. I don't need you to trust me. I need you to trust the government of South Orange. That's who you need to trust. It's the institution that has lost the trust over the years, many government institutions, and that's where we need to put it back. And so by putting something like the budget online and letting people see that, we started to say, hey, like, if you can find something that we haven't fixed, if you have a better idea for something that we're doing, I mean, I'd like to save money too, so please tell us. And I think just the process of doing that and putting it up there and showing that we're not hiding anything and we want this to be a collaborative process started to make people feel like, oh, I can actually be a part of this, because there were people who would come to our governing body meetings, you know, and kind of lodge a complaint about a budget line. And I was like, hey, man, look, if you figure out how to solve that, like, here's my email, please tell me. Because, like, this is our budget. I would like to fix it. And I think just having that general attitude of, like, we're totally fallible. I'm sure there's mistakes in there. I'm sure there's things that are not the most efficient. And why not open that up to the community at large to see where the next great idea could come from? Why wouldn't we want to take advantage of that? And I think that people see that that was an authentic interest and that when they started participating, we started listening. And that, you know, slowly starts to bring people more into the process.
And all of you... figured out ways what's interesting to me in reading about all of you is that you've figured out ways to partner with people outside of government and institutions outside of government to get things done. If you talk about that, because I think that none of you were in a position to just rely on your tax base. So at some point you had to say, I've got to figure out another way. Mayor Warren, you went to United Way and involved them and others, right?
Yes. We have a great partnership with our foundations and local United Way, as well as businesses. One thing about our community that we know is that we our businesses, our philanthropic community, they give a lot to Rochester and to the challenges that we have. Our community is program rich and results poor. If you have a problem in our city, we have a program that is supposed to fix it, but for some reason we have, you know, there's a disconnect between getting those services to the people that are, you know, in need of it, or the survival of the program becomes so much more important than the mission of the program that we have been able to see situations where people have not been able to get the support that they've needed. So we went out and we worked with the Community Foundation, worked with the United Way. We're currently in the process of working with the governor, the state of New York, our New York State Assembly majority leader, the county executive, the city of Rochester, foundations, and everyone around our anti-poverty initiative. We have a aggressive goal of reducing poverty in our target area by 50% in 15 years. And we're working hard to do that. But what we recognize is that government can't do it alone. That our problems have become, you know, so large that, you know, and people are looking for us to do more, meaning the city, meaning government, to do more than what was traditionally in the governmental realm. You know, before it was really about picking up garbage, making sure when you called a firefighter that they came to pick, that they came to put out the fire. When you called a police officer, that they were there, that the streets were clean, that when it snowed, that the snow was plowed. But now many people are looking to their government to get involved in a lot of the things that are plaguing them socially. And because of that, we recognize that we don't have the resources or the ability to tax our way out of the problems that we have. Rochester was and is still home to three large companies, Kodak, Xerox, and Bausch & Lomb. At one point in time in our community, these companies employed over 100,000 people. Now today, they employ less than 15,000. That is a challenge for us because those individuals that used to work there, many of them that were highly technical, highly skilled, started their own businesses, small companies, and that's really the bread and butter of our community today. But we also have many people that were able to have a high school diploma and go and work on a factory line. And then now they have their children have found a situation where they don't have anywhere to go. They don't have that industry that they can go and work in and take care of their families. And so we have to reimagine how we do things. And that's the reason why we're looking at market-driven community co-ops. We're looking at, you know, van pools and other ways in which we can help our citizens that and our private industries, our businesses, as well as our philanthropic community can help us, you know, lift our children and lift our citizens out of poverty.
You mentioned market-driven community co-ops. This is employee-owned businesses.
Yes.
that you're trying to, and you borrowed the idea. You got the idea from Cleveland.
Yes.
Where does this stand? Give us the genesis of this, because it's really interesting. And where is it now?
Well, when I came into office, I created a Office of Innovation and Strategic Initiatives. And this is really the research and development arm of the city of Rochester. They were charged with looking at our most challenged areas in poverty and trying to figure out new innovative ways to help our citizens that we've never tried before. You know, it's one tool in a toolbox. And they researched what they're doing in Cleveland around the Cleveland co-ops. Cleveland was able to start a hydroponic facility. They have a solar facility, community-driven co-op, as well as a laundry facility. So we looked at what could we do in Rochester by working with our anchor institutions. We have great universities and colleges in our area. We also have a really robust healthcare industry in Rochester. And we also have Wegmans, which is the best grocery store in the country. And so I'll tell them.
Please.
But we have some great anchor institutions, and the motto that Cleveland started was to utilize the anchor institutions to basically stabilize the business, and then you know, have the foundations, and Cleveland Foundation was the one that put up the capital to actually fund the market-driven co-op. We have a foundation in our community. And the Community Foundation, that we're looking to not put in as much into the bricks and mortar, the upfront cost. We are looking at different businesses. One is green infrastructure, green construction, and the other is LED lighting. Currently, there are no LED lighting manufacturing facilities in northeastern United States. We currently ship those lights from China. If we can be competitive and actually manufacture those right in Rochester, we will look to do that, and we're in the process of doing that.
Did I read that the social impact bonds are going to be
you we're floated? Looking at social, we're looking at social impact bonds as well.
Cool. Does everyone know social impact bonds? It's sort of it's an innovative mechanism that I won't do this justice. That combines the private sector, the public sector, and nonprofit management. And what's great about social impact bonds or pay for success bonds is the investors only see only get returns on their investment when societal goals are met. So it there's an incentive to actually do things right.
The investors put up the upfront costs. So a lot of times what happens is instead of government coming in and funding a program at $100,000 on the front end, the investors will put in the $100,000 to get it started to say, is this really going to work? And if it does work and it achieves the goals, then the government will pay the investors back their money plus interest, because in the long run, we'll be saving money. And so it shows that we would have to show that you'll get the best return on the investment by actually getting the result that you're looking for.
That's a much better explanation than I was struggling with. Mayor Fetterman, you saw an opportunity.
With healthcare, with partnering outside. Has anyone heard of UPMC? Mm-hmm. Yeah, if you haven't, you will soon. They're like the invading horde in healthcare. And they are buying up hospital systems all across at least western Pennsylvania. And I think they've moved as far west as Harrisburg. That stands for University of Pittsburgh Medical Center. And it started out as this benevolent healthcare organization spun out of the University of Pittsburgh. And it began to buy hospitals, build hospitals. And suddenly quickly became the state's largest employer in Pennsylvania. It has 57,000 employees. It has a CEO who makes $6.5 million. Nice work if you can get it. And behaves as a for-profit institution, ruthless, I would say, almost. And as you may or may not agree with me, healthcare, I think, is best when you have innovation, but it's not profit-driven, because you leave out, there's no money to be made in providing healthcare for people that can't afford it, typically from people from communities like my own. So back in 2009, I got a phone call on Halloween, and they said, well, you know, we're closing your hospital in town, John. And it was like, wow, you know, to give you an idea, this is 270,000 square feet, which is the size of like two Walmarts. And, you know, we're not a big town, unlike Rochester. We're a small community. So this was like one of the few remaining crown jewels of Braddock's heyday. And it was a major employer, and most importantly, it was a major, it's the only access point to healthcare in our community. So needless to say, it was devastating, particularly since this company, this nonprofit, wink, wink, would generate $400 to $500 million a year in surplus, but it really is profit. And they're like, well, your hospital's losing money, and people aren't using it, da-da-da-da-da. I'm like, well, then how do you explain 23,000 emergency room visits every year if people aren't using your hospital? So basically, they closed the hospital, and we as a community went into a downward spiral when it comes to access to healthcare. And put it in perspective, we are the poorest community in Allegheny County. Allegheny County is the second largest county in Pennsylvania, second only to Philadelphia. We are the poorest community within Allegheny County. So long story short, we were able to partner with Highmark Health, and they opened up the finest urgent care health facility of its kind in western Pennsylvania, thus bringing back healthcare. But we went 5 years without access to healthcare in our community. And this center has demonstrably saved lives, including my own campaign treasurer, who was kind of lightheaded, acting odd, and I insisted Ms. Phyllis go in and get checked out, and her blood pressure spiked, and she was just about ready to stroke out. And even my mother-in-law, that's my wife Giselle up here, she started feeling really bad, and she's like, oh, I don't want to go to the hospital or to the doctor. We took her there, and she turned out she had Lyme disease. So the access to healthcare in residents, especially in a community that is a poor community, is so critical, and we would never have been able to get those resources if we didn't partner. The second one, I'll run quickly. Has anyone heard of Levi's? Mm-hmm. Yeah. Hey. So we were approached by Levi Strauss roughly around the same time the hospital, UPMC, closed, and they said, we like what you're doing in town. We want to partner with you, and we want to feature your community in our national ad campaign, and what can we do for you? So they made an extraordinary large donation to our nonprofit, and 100% of the funds proceeds and it fixed up a new community center in town where we didn't have, and it also installed security cameras in our troubled sections that dropped gunfire instances down to zero, and also created, we didn't even have functioning playgrounds when I took office, and it did a lot of great things. So two non-traditional partnerships that really helped our community move forward.
Mayor Torpey, about you and thinking outside the box in terms of partnering with entities.
Yeah, so I think one of the one of the challenges that we had in South Orange is, so we're in a metropolitan area outside of New York City, and a lot of these areas that are right next to train stations and have kind of small, we have like a very small clustered urban-like downtown, an old suburb, or a first suburb is what a lot of folks are calling it. The development potential, the worth of a lot of that land is astronomically large, and a lot of these towns are seeing development that they can't really control, right? High-rises are getting built, rents are going up, people are getting priced out, and you're just moving poverty around to different places, you're moving people around, changing the dynamics of school districts, of how people utilize public transportation, how people get access to healthcare, all these different things, just based on the fact that governments want to sell land to make money, which is reasonable to want to do, but there's all these other consequences and things that need to be paid attention to there. So in South Orange, we have this interest. Developers were, looking at the town. There are all these different plots of land around this train station, where you're in walking distance to, a performing arts center that we recently built, open space, all this great stuff, and to Seton Hall University. And one of the things that we did that was sort of outside the typical, there's no statutory power, was basically become like a facilitator and a moderator between redevelopers and community members and community groups. They would come to us and they would, these like, okay, here, business cards, like, this looks great. We're going to build these things. And, and they would give us the numbers, show us the renderings they would do of how great the buildings would look, and talk about how much more money is going to come into the municipal budget, once that land starts generating tax. I'm like, well, this is great, on one hand, because maybe we can raise enough money that we can provide the services that people expect without laying off police officers or firefighters, without raising taxes on single-family homeowners. But the rents were exploding, and our core downtown, our central business district, didn't have any affordable housing at all. And housing was so expensive, in fact, I'm a little embarrassed to admit it, but my last year in office, I moved back in with my parents in South Orange. And the rent was considerably cheaper, and that was a pretty kind of eye-opening experience for me.
When you went on a date, did you tell the girl that you had two roommates?
Yeah, exactly. No, my parents lived with me. On that glorious $0 a year mayor salary. So the rent was expensive. All these things were happening. I was like, I want to do redevelopment. We have such great potential here. I believe that we should be not chopping trees down to build new houses, but we should be infilling in areas where there's already pavement there that's already covered. Like, what can we do to make this and do it better? And so we started sitting down with community groups when developers would approach us. I would say, well, you want to build this in this part of town here, and here are our requirements. And if you can't meet these requirements, we don't really want you here. And you need to get the sign off of this historic association. We're gonna set the meeting up. We're gonna be there with you. We're gonna talk to them. We're gonna talk to you. We're gonna facilitate this whole process. We're gonna try and bring people to the same page. But if you can't get the community interested and okay with doing this redevelopment project, then we're not going to give you the approvals. We're not gonna give you the zoning. We're not gonna do anything. and we're not going to be cooperative at all. And we earned this really interesting reputation where there are developers in New Jersey, especially around that area outside of New York City, where it is just the amount of attention there right now is incredible. There are developers that won't set foot in South Orange because they have to go through this process of meeting with community members. Where for us, that was a value as part of our community, was like, I don't want you to build in South Orange if you're not going to build something that our community members like. And just because we're going to get more money in the budget, we want it to aesthetically fit in town. We want to talk about what kind of businesses are going to go in there and who you want to get in there. We're going to talk about whether you're going to do on-site or off-site affordable housing, all these different things that were really important to us. And so the developers that don't want to do that stuff basically kind of stopped coming. And in the beginning, they were all over. I mean, it was like meeting after meeting with developers in the beginning. And at a certain point, it started to kind of cool down a little bit, where we got to a point where we had developers that were really interested in these things. And they wanted to build things that had that were beautiful buildings, not just like, let's fit as many apartments in as possible. They wanted to do things that would provide housing for Seton Hall students who had to live in other towns because rents were too expensive. And we started building, we started doing redevelopment projects, and now we have affordable housing in our downtown for the first time ever in the town's history that we haven't had before. And that's within walking distance of the train, to bus lines, to everything that you could possibly need. And we're trying to do that in a way where, you know, we're holding diversity as a value, but we don't control the school district either. You know, we want to do redevelopment, but we don't control the sale of private property necessarily. There's all these things that are semi in our control, but mostly out of our control. But what we did was show people how good it could be if they worked with the values that the community has. And so we would set up those meetings, and the community members, you know, would come to these meetings. And I think in the beginning, people didn't really trust that we were going to actually take what they were saying seriously. But eventually people kind of started to see that, like, you know, we're not going to just, you know, cross a project out because it, you know, people say, oh, it's too dense. We'll say, well, let's like look at this. Let's like actually have the conversation. And so people participated in it, developers participated, and the projects that we did when I was in office and the projects that they're doing now are ones that basically have the seal of the approval from the community. And I don't know how many people have gone to like land use board meetings here. I got a couple nods. We're super exciting ways to spend 5 or 6 or 10 hours, you know, on a Monday night. We would do projects and we'd be getting approvals for developers. And people, you know, this is not always the case, but on several occasions, people were in the community, you know, in support of it. And like, when does that happen? Right. And you had people on the land use boards that, you know, felt like, hey, we went through everything. This looks great. And but we did all that work ahead of time with community members that were bought in, and they knew that their input in the process wasn't just one stakeholder. It was the stakeholder that had to be met.
You three are obviously, personality-wise, you're change makers. Right, your change agents. I'm wondering. I last night at the Story Slam, former mayor John Street told a wacky story, very funny. But I was talking to him and about his 8 years as mayor. He said the biggest challenge, I wonder if you relate to this, was what he calls the B team in city government. They're the city workers who would either overtly or by implication be saying to him, in effect, I'd be here when you came, and I'm going to be here when you're gone. That idea that well, we've never done it that way before, so we're not going to change. Does that sound familiar to you? Did you get pushback from your own government? And if so, did that surprise you? Anyone?
I didn't really get pushback from our city hall workers. I think that we, you know, in Rochester, we have a great team of employees that work hard every day. You know, working in public service is not easy. And they come to work excited and doing the work that they need to do every day. I think that for me, it was more so, you know, you're stepping into a realm that we've never stepped into before when it comes down to more so our city council and, you know, many citizens, that we're going into a direction that government has not really looked at. But, you know, when you have citizens that are challenged and neighborhoods that are definitely challenged, you have to think outside the box. We can't continue to do the same thing over and over again and think that we're going to get a different result. And so we have to have different tools, and new innovative tools. And other cities have tried this and have been successful. And so you look at what you have in your community, how you can tailor what they've done in theirs to fit your community, and you try it. And last year I had the opportunity to go to Israel. And one of the things that I learned there, it was just as so powerful, is how they really empower their young people to try. This thing where, even if you fail, the fact that you try to this new innovative business, you'll learn something from doing it. So don't be afraid to fail. And so I think that we've gotten so, reserved in, if it doesn't work out, then, you'll take the political hit. You'll be hurt by it. But what if it does? What if it is successful? What if this is the game changer for our community? One of the things that was very important for me when I took office was really going out and telling Rochester's story, that we are still a community that can build upon our legacy of Kodak, Xerox, and Bosch & Lomb. Last year, the vice president came to Rochester to announce that we are now going to be known as the photonics capital of the world because of what we did in the past around imaging and the fact that Kodak was there. And those types of relationships that you build by going to the federal government, the state government, meeting with citizens, reaching across the aisles to different businesses and not-for-profits, that type of thinking is a little bit different. But you have to do it because everyone needs to know that even though we have our challenges, our opportunities are even greater if we are not afraid to move forward.
I think that's Israel. There's a book, Startup Nation, about mm-hmm. Israel. You're absolutely right. In Silicon Valley, the same way. You're looked upon with suspicion if you haven't failed at something. and that's a cultural mind shift. Mayor Fetterman, what's been your biggest challenge?
How much time do you have? it's all a challenge. I don't consider myself a change maker. Towns, we've made a lot of improvements and everything, but it's still a difficult place, and it probably always will be. It's been my life's work now for, I've been in town for 15 years and mayor for 11, and it'll take decades more after that. And that's why I decided to run for higher office, is because it distresses me deeply that there's only so much that we can do on the ground. It's the old, why are there so many people drowning in the river? It's like, well, I want to go upstream to find out who's throwing them in, because it's really hard. And we're horribly over mismatched based on a lot of societal trends, whether it's globalization, deindustrialization, suburbanization, and a lot of these other things. So the challenge is, you never get the chance to feel good about it. You never get a chance to celebrate your successes, because your phone will ring, as mine did while I was here in Philadelphia, that our major retailer in town, Family Dollar, had closed their store because of subsidence in their store, because it was built on an old site where we had to tear down some stuff, and it wasn't done properly, and it struck. In a community where if you don't have cars, how do you get diapers, formula, and all these different things? And it's such a low-level Maslow kind of challenge, and it's like, East Orange, it's like, we don't have developers collaborating. I'd be like, we don't get what we want, because it's more like, you have to remember, where the power dynamic is, and it's been with us is convincing people in government and nonprofits and others to actually care about a community like mine. And these places do in fact matter. And there's an entire roster of them in our state here in Pennsylvania. And that was my race, what my race was all about.
Can you share with the audience your tattoo?
Well, this is Braddock zip code. If I ever get lost, you can dump me in the mailbox and guaranteed return postage, although that would probably cost a lot for the post office. But the other one is our dates in when we've lost people through violence in my communities since I've been mayor. And they have one thing in common, well, many things in common, I should say. They were all African American. They all had people that loved them and missed them terribly now. And they were all senseless. And the hyper majority of them were gun related. And it was sad. And if someone said, what's the thing you're most proud of? It's like, well, we went 5.5 years without the loss of life in my community. But nevertheless, it's an anxiety. It's a sadness that never leaves because, as I don't have to tell any of you, that can change at an instant in our gun obsessed culture in that regard. So I started doing this back in 2006 because I don't know if other mayors can speak to this. I'm sure they can. When you see your first victim, you know, on your watch, and you see the carnage, and you see the sorrow, and you see the family members coming to the scene, it stays with you. So I started doing that as a way to kind of communicate, you know, my commitment to it, but also to kind of document it in a way that this wasn't just a blurb on the evening news. This was a senseless loss of life, you know, in our community.
Good for you.
I want to invite you to actually sign our petition, 100 Cities United Against Gun Violence, trying to find solutions. I started this probably in June of 2017. In 2016, we're looking for 100 cities to be united in June of 17 to declare June Gun Violence Awareness Month because of this very important issue you just spoke about. We have a lot of senseless acts of violence in our communities, mine included, and too many young people are losing their lives to gun violence, and we need to stand united in order to deal with these issues and call on our congressional representatives to change the gun laws and look at background checks as well as the no-fly, no-buy list.
When I was in graduate school, one of the big names in it, and he's now an even bigger name, was Richard Florida. You know, anyone know Richard Florida, the creative class and all that stuff? And I found a lot of that methodology and a lot of that thinking kind of, I disagreed with a lot of it. Because it only focused on the people that were already doing well. And, you know, it's like, how can we make Portland, Oregon even more delightful? How can we make San Francisco's dining scene even more, you know, compelling? And it celebrates the privilege that of a lot of the people that get to enjoy and create these hyper urbane, stratified cities like Portland, like San Francisco. What have you, and it leaves behind an entire roster of communities like my own, perhaps, you know, these legacy cities. That's the new euphemism that the Urban Land Institute categorized, and that's like, what's the solution for those places? You know, in his book, he actually calls some of these towns hopeless, and I'm just like, you just written off, you know, two-thirds of America, you know, and, you know, he used to brag that, you know, his ad that his group worked on was the most successful one for BMW, and I'm like, good for you, man. You know, way to go. You know, and I ran for my office because, like, we need, to me, that's what I think one of the most pressing public policy issues is, that we need to figure out a way to revitalize cities without making it gentrification first. You know, in Pittsburgh, where Braddock is in the Pittsburgh area, is a, you know, central casting example of gentrification. They evicted about 250 mostly low-income African Americans from housing, and they're going to build an even bigger Whole Foods in the neighborhood. There's already one. They're building an even bigger one. I mean, you couldn't create a more, you know, kind of damning optic in terms of that kind of development. And I understand the need for economic development, but it distresses me to no end that there are so many communities that will never get their Whole Foods and they'll never have these kind of answers. And that has been why I got into this, and that's why I constantly struggle to find avenues to advance those ideas.
Thank you, Mayor Warren.
Thank you.
Thank you. I want to hear from you guys and throw some, if you have questions, raise your hand and I'll, yes, Mr. Marzano.
Hi, Nick Marzano with Young Involved Philadelphia. And I actually want to ask a question. said, and related to some of the community-based budgeting that Alex was talking about, it seems like there's a trend and an important trend towards getting citizens involved in government, reworking, rethinking some of the services that we expect from our taxes, and investing some of our time in there instead. And I think that, personally, I think there's a lot to be gained in terms of civic participation from being more active than voting twice a year, hopefully, or once a year, even, hopefully. But then it brings up the point that you just mentioned. The people who have the most time to get involved are those who have a comfortable job, who can go to those meetings, not worry about three kids and the two or three jobs that they're trying to hold down. What are some of the most, I guess the question is, what are some of the most effective ways that you have seen governments engage citizens equitably beyond voting? Or is it a matter of really just top-down being the voice of those that don't have the time? Is there a way to engage equitably in tactical urbanism?
Well, yeah, that's a very thorough question. I mean, when I started, you know, the town was really written off, and they wanted to build a 4-lane highway through the middle of it. You know, talk about environmental racism. You know, there wasn't a functioning playground, and it was one of two places in the region as a whole in Allegheny County where you just didn't want to go. So. And I got my start actually, you know, helping young people get their GEDs, and I helped their young people get jobs, and really understood and embraced kind of the nuts and bolts of exactly where we're starting. So, you know, if I've been successful at doing anything in Braddock, it's been understanding just how severe the challenges are. We have an outstanding pre-K program in Braddock. I wrote an op-ed for Philly Magazine supporting the soda tax. I think that's brilliant. I think if families of whatever political stripe you are understood how dramatically different the lives and the challenges faced in low-income households are in terms of childhood development, everybody would clamor to increase the soda tax, because it's so crucial. Because if you don't get that kind of service and that kind of attention, by the time they enter kindergarten, you will create a tower of inequality in that child's life. And that education gap will never be closed. And you'll pay for it as a society, and that person will pay for it as an individual and be punished for it for the rest of their lives. So, I tried to understand exactly where we were starting from and where we wanted to go. And some of the things that I've done were considered unorthodox by some of the town elders, if you will. But I never let that stop. Thankfully, there's this thing called an election every 4 years where you have to go before the people and they have to vote you up or down. And my first race in 2005, I won by one vote. And I'm not making that up. That's not a Lifetime movie script where it's like the plucky mayor wins by one vote. I literally won by one vote. And it was actually a tie. It was a provisional ballot that broke the tie. And then the second election, I won by 2/3 margin. And then the last one was nearly 8-1 margin. So I use that as my barometer to say, well, is what we're doing being valued? Is what we're doing working? And that to me is the ultimate barometer of how I'm able to engage citizens. And my lovely wife, who's up here, could tell you a lot of the great works that she has done. And you know, she's done a lot, you know, of really incredible things in town, and has helped infuse a level of energy that is needed in terms of leadership, and also a lot of creative ideas as well too. So we're super engaged in a smaller town like ours. You really know, you know, a lot of things that you know Jim Kenney can't possibly know, you know, 2 million people. In our situation, it's much different, and you can, you know, be much more hands-on. So that's, you know, really how we engage. If people need clothes for back to school, my wife can help out. If they need food, we can help out. If we're engaged at a level that I think few mayors are, and I think that's a function of our commitment, but it's a function also of our town size and what we hope to accomplish.
Mayor Torpey, you, under your watch, I believe violent crime dropped 40%. Mm-hmm. And my understanding is that that was, at least in part, due to what you were talking about vis-a-vis the developers, which is sort of being the middle person between the community and the police. Can you expand on that?
Yeah, sure. I mean, so it was, you know, I had an interesting perspective. Before I ran for office, I was a volunteer emergency medical technician in South Orange. And so when I got back from college and I started getting involved in town, that was one of the things that I had always been curious about. And it was a fascinating learning experience for me. I got to meet police officers, got to meet firefighters, got to meet the EMTs, and be out on calls and see what was going on and talk to them and hear what some of the problems were. And they would complain about technology that they had at the police department. The radios weren't working. I'm like, why don't the radios work? He's like, well, I don't know. We keep telling them about it and it's not somehow making it up there. I'm like, well, that's crazy. Like, how can you not have that? And you just start to get exposed to these different things that, you know, a lot of people who, you know, run for office, especially at, you know, a lot of high levels of government, I don't think they have seen their community that level of hands-on, like what you were just talking about. And just seeing out there, I mean, if there was an arm, you know, a lot, the armed robberies or the one shooting that we had in South Orange when I was in office, I was on call that night. And, you know, you see that. And, you know, I remember sitting in the back of the ambulance one night and I was taking a, you know, medical history from someone who had just been a victim of an armed robbery and was asking the basic questions, you know, medical history, you know, what medications you take. And one of the answers that he gave, he was like, no, I don't have any allergies, Mr. Mayor. And I was like, ah, okay. And I was like, well, we should chat about that right now. Like, I'm an EMT and I need to like make sure you're okay and we're going to take you up to the hospital. But like, here's my cell phone number and my office hours are on Monday and you should come in and we should talk more about that because that's really important. And, you know, it was a perspective gained about what was happening. And I think that, you know, when I came in, one of your questions earlier was kind of like how you, you know, dealt with like your staff or your administration. And I think that, you know, being younger than, you know, all the department heads, police chief, fire chief, everybody like that, almost all of our police officers, you know, it's a very delicate situation. You don't want to come in there, even if you've got things that, you know, excited about doing, you don't want to come in and be the bull in the china shop. And so I think that, you know, from that perspective, people saw like, hey, you've got this perspective here. You know, you're willing to learn a little bit. You're taking in all of this and then filtering that and figuring out what to do. And people appreciated that. And then from the, you know, police perspective, I think it allowed me and the rest of our administration and the governing body to end up improving relations, you know, with our police department. And so we invested more in technology and we figured out what exactly wasn't working and what we needed to do. We figured out what parts of town had bigger problems, figured out what parts of town had stronger, you know, neighborhood watch programs versus others and why some did or didn't. We figured out why the security cameras weren't working or what resources they needed or just little things like morale, like, oh, we haven't had a professional cleaning service come in and clean the basement of the police department in X many years because that was a budget line that was cut and we're expecting the police officers to do that themselves while we're paying them an hourly rate to be a police officer, we're going to expect you to clean. And like that's not the same way, you know, where we clean our rescue squad because we're volunteers, so it doesn't cost anybody anything to have us do that. And you know, just paying attention. There's these studies, you know, that we talk about in, you know, public administration programs where, you know, when people would study, you know, factory workers, you know, that the efficiency improved even without any changes being made, just because people knew that people were paying attention to them. And I think that you kind of have that impact on your municipal staff. So we made the right investments. I think we built better relationships. And it shows because not only do we have a police department that's phenomenally effective, but their relationship with our community is incredibly strong. And the relationship with communities of color within South Orange is one of the most profoundly positive relationships that I've seen ever in law enforcement in a community. And after a lot of the violence that's happened, you know, in the past couple years, in the past couple weeks, past couple months, you know, our community members came together that were organized by young organizers that were just out of high school, clergy members, the police departments, the current mayor of our town and the town that we share a border with and a school district with. And they came together and held a community event where they talked about the violence that people of color felt against themselves. Law enforcement talked about the violence that they felt. And they had an incredibly deep conversation that ended up being really constructive. And our police department, you know, helped lead that conversation. And the fact that they have that relationship with our community means that when someone is concerned, when someone is scared, when they think they see a crime, they call the police because they know the police are their allies. And that again, it's like going back to that same trust thing. I mean, if you don't trust the law enforcement, why would you ever call them on a crime? If you call them and you think that they might come down and they're going to question you because you're there and you're a person of color. And we don't have that dynamic in South Orange and in Maplewood, and our, you know, department closely resembles the racial makeup of the town. And the leadership in the department and the leadership in the town understand this as a value the same way that our community, which is very diverse, does. And so when you look at like something like improving the crime over the years, there's the technology piece, there's the improving the infrastructure piece, but it comes back to me, and everything that I learned from doing this was the relationships between the government and the citizens is the most important thing that can be improved. And if you can fix that, if you can bring those two groups together as partners, then the kind of problems that you can solve is pretty limitless.
Mayor Fetterman, you just ran for U.S. Senate and ran a terrific campaign. I can't tell you how many people I talked to who said, that guy Fetterman's amazing. I would have thought you were going to win in a landslide based on everyone's commentary. What is your takeaway of this experience? We talked a little bit about this earlier.
Sure. Well, I mean, I've had a lot of takeaways, and it was an incredibly positive experience overall. And there isn't anything I wouldn't change about it. Actually, I got to meet a lot of great people. I had some folks from Doylestown coming up and saying hello, and the message resonated. I'd be lying if I said when I started my campaign I didn't think, well, could I fill a room? Could I fill an event room in Philadelphia or in Doylestown or whatever? I'm out here out west. And the answer, thankfully, it turned out to be yes. But the big takeaway is money. You know, how many people think there's too much money in politics? Well, relax, it's much worse than you think. and it's true. That system has to change. And it, you know, that gentleman asked, you know, what's an interference between the government and the citizens? And that's money, you know. If he can give me $25, but she can give me $2,500, who am I going to spend more time with? Who am I going to listen to? Who am I going to call? Who am I going to call on? And that's what the system requires of people running for office. And it is gross, and it is transactional, and it is something that I never was able to embrace because I couldn't pretend that I just don't work people for money. You know, it's the current election laws and the way that it's structured with TV, it turns candidates into telemarketers. And I think of the time that candidates and actually elected officials spend on the phone calling people for money and going to fundraisers, that's time taken away from you and the ideas and the problems and the issues that we have in this country. And you know, it is much worse than anybody thinks. And you know, does anyone here like to call people on the phone, strangers, for money? I've never had anyone raise their hand. How many people like to be called by strangers on the phone, you know, asking for money? So it's a process that nobody likes, whether it's the candidate or whether it's the people that are called themselves. Yet it is the thing that is poisoning our democracy at such a basic level. I think the lasting and enduring legacy from Senator Sanders' run is going to be this idea that you can actually have a campaign for a significant office and do it with $27 donations. And you're not accountable to the big dollars. It's like, you know, your opinion matters to me as much as her opinion matters to me, you know, because I'm not having to work one of you over for a bigger check. And I was never able to do that, and that explains my embarrassing fundraising total, you know. But let me put that in perspective. I raised $650,000, and that sounds like a lot of money, particularly when you're coming from a community where you can buy a house for $6,000. But that's a rounding error in Senate campaigns. But we were still able to get 20% statewide, and I won my home county in Allegheny.
Which Bernie did not, right?
Yeah, Bernie did not. He lost by 12 points, I think. So so message matters, but money matters too much. And I can just say that I hope everyone, you know, hears that call where we get money out of our politics to much, you know, Citizens United. I don't want to tell my son, you know, when he's old enough to vote in 11 years, that it cost $10 billion to run for president. I mean, it's perverse.
So what can we do about that? What I mean, we're at the Citizen, we're trying to focus on solutions. One of the root causes, of course, is the cost of television advertising. But what do you do outside of public financing, which is not going to pass Congress, right?
Yeah, well, I mean, it's what is that called? Codependent, you know, they enable each other. You think that, you know, where does all that money that they raise go? Well, to media. So you think they're going to want to push that message like, no, cut us off, you know, like, you know, take the trough away. We've had too much. And Republicans, like the Supreme Court, they can't make a, I mean, that's 4-4. Like we can't, I mean, you know, Citizens United has to be repealed. And I mean, that's just the fact of it. Thank you. And I just wish there was like a movie like Super Size Me for campaign finance, where you go behind and you actually are able to feel the visceral revulsion of calling people and money and the kind of moral compromises that you're forced to try to make as candidates. It has to change, and it's not like you're going to, you know, give somebody a favorable, you know, graft for over $1,000 or whatever. It's just, it shouldn't be about money. It should be about ideas, and it should be about, you know, issues. And really, money is a proxy for far too much of a candidate's life. And it also helps keep out a lot of people of color, and it helps keep out women, because their society is unequal, and it has to be made more equal. And that's not Pollyanna. It's like Citizens United has turned on a geyser of money, and it's only getting worse and worse and worse with each passing year.
One of the things that we were chatting about a little bit before, so that was a horrifyingly, you know, a disturbing experience from the fundraising, it sounds like, from the Senate perspective. But when you were running for mayor, you were saying it wasn't as bad.
No, it's easy. My community isn't like the size of Rochester or anything. But in terms of the Senate race, money. It's like, did you ever see the movie Wall Street? You know, with Charlie Sheen back in '87, and Hal Holbrook says to young Charlie Sheen, he's like, you know, bud, that's the thing about money. It makes you do things you don't want to do, and that's the true in politics. And it's like, there's far too much influence of money in politics. And you know, it's not a problem unless you can figure out a solution. It's like, well, my solution, and I think that a lot of other people feel the same way, is first turning off this ridiculous thing called Citizens United. You can give unlimited money. And is it any wonder that you can literally raise hundreds of millions of dollars? And again, coming from a poor town like mine, like this race in Pennsylvania is going to cost $50 million when it's all said and done. To basically call each other poopy pants and manipulate you into thinking one's better than the other, vice versa. What would $50 million do for my town or his town or any town? And it's all going to be used for name calling and these kind of issues. And it's like, you know, there's money in our society for things. And unfortunately, it goes to things like that instead of the basic fundamental needs. And that exacerbates the inequality that we have in our society.
The priorities seem to be all messed up, and you know, I think that what's exciting, even though it's a pretty daunting challenge, is the number of opportunities there are that exist in this country to be a leader of a community without having to necessarily engage with all that. I mean, we're exposed on a pretty regular basis, especially, you know, I would anticipate most of the folks in the room, you know, we're all fairly engaged with what's happening, especially in Philly right now. I feel like there's something happening. And that is where our attention keeps getting pulled to. It keeps getting pulled to this like name calling back and forth. And I know for me, I mean, I love government and the idea of governance and thinking about these things and talking about these things. I cannot stand the news right now. I cannot stand what is being talked about. I'm not interested in it. It makes me upset. It makes me scared. All these negative emotions, and it's just not constructive. Yet you can go to community across the country. There are school boards, there are town councils, there are mayors, there are county commissioners, there are state legislators, there are people that are on more local levels of government who are doing real work. I mean, what you've heard, I know, from us so far tonight is the tip of the iceberg of what has happened, you know, in our communities. And we're the tippiest small part of the iceberg of the number of people around the country that are doing this kind of work right now. And we just keep getting distracted and pulled in these directions, and right in front of us. It's harder if you live in a city. It's harder to sometimes get involved, but there are so many opportunities that I think that you guys have brought a lot of attention to in Philly and outside of any city, even in the metropolitan areas surrounding, to make real progress that doesn't require raising that kind of money, that doesn't require being a person who's, you know, polished in front of a TV camera, doesn't require you affiliating with a party, doesn't require any of those things that we're so expected that, you know, to be a change maker in government or in politics that you have to do. There are ways to do it without doing that. And what I think is exciting about what the Philly Citizen's doing, what's exciting about what I hope younger generations kind of move towards, is that you've got this generation that is not super interested in, like, careerism, right, of, like, having a job and then, like, remaining in that job for 20 years. I can't even, like, I mean, the four-year term for me as a mayor, I was like, oh, my God, this is such, I mean, this is the only other commitment I've made that long is college, I guess, and that's, like, not really a fair comparison, right? And, like, I'm not, you know, I'm not trying to be in one place for that amount of time. So we've got young people that sign up for Teach for America. We've got young people who join the Peace Corps. We've got young people who join the military. We've got young people who join AmeriCorps. All these service organizations where your impact in your community is incredible. The value to yourself is incredible. But throughout the process, you don't really make any money. And it's really, really hard for that period of time. So how do we take that energy of all those people going towards those service programs and get those people to run for local office and take that and change all of these communities? Forget the federal government, forget Congress. Like, they're not going to help us. You know, they're in doing this thing, and, you know, and I would love to change it, and, you know, and I think there's a lot of people in this room who would do great at changing it, but that process of getting there is so insane. You know, what if we took all that energy, all that money, and focused all of that in communities and figured out what we could do from there?
Well, and that's what you're doing now, is trying to get young people to run for office. Yeah. So, but the hard part about that is convincing them that it matters. Both of you have said you don't want to be called politicians. That's become a cancerous word, right?
Well, I mean, like, we don't need a revolution. We just need common sense. Like, it's like, can you live off $8 an hour? Oh, of course nobody can. So then why don't we pay people a wage that they can actually support themselves and live in dignity and support their families? Like, that's not a revolution, that's common sense. It's like, should we control something like guns that in the wrong hands kills people on a documented basis? Yeah, that's kind of common sense. You know, should we allow unlimited money and influence in American politics and policy? Probably not. It probably might skew things. I mean, it's like this whole idea of the word revolution gets thrown around a lot, and it makes it seem so epic, or it makes it seem like scaling an impossibly high mountain. And it's really just, it's been the death of common sense, and this idea that we shouldn't implement basic fundamental things that would make society much more just, much more fair, much more safe. And it just really is just common sense. It's not an idea that you know, you need to, you know, do. I mean, I'm tired of studies. There's studies on studies at this point, you know? Like, you know, we know that there's a problem, and it's like we need to move past this hyper-partisanship, this tribalism that we have in our country, and just implement common sense reforms. And, like, for example, $15 an hour, you know, living wage. People scoff and they, like, oh, you know, you $15 an hour to work at McDonald's, or are you crazy, or Walmart, you know? Well, Walmart gets a $6.2 billion subsidy from you because their employees take that much in government assistance just to make ends meet. So you're paying for it one way or the other. You know, why not build that dignity in the front end so they don't have to live in poverty if they're working full time? I mean, and again, if that's, God help us if that's revolutionary. That to me is, if I drop this glass, we know what's going to happen. If we pay people $8 an hour, we definitely know what's going to happen. And why don't we want to take those fundamental steps to change that?
Any other questions? Yes, sir.
Mayor John, I'm Al McDuffie.
Oh, yes, sir. I called him sir.
Yeah, sure.
So I guess I have two questions from that. One, do you ever wonder what happens if
Sure. It's not all waiting on me, you know, like that's vanity, you know, like it's, you know, I don't stress about it if when I'm gone, and my wife would be much better at it too. Every other day I'm like, do you want to be married? But it's like, what do we need? It's like the only thing that's ever made any difference in a community like mine is resources, ideas, and people getting involved and attention, you know? Like when you lost 90% of your population, you know, you don't have developers, you know, wanting to build. You don't have hospitals, nonprofits even wanting to stick around and provide healthcare for those that can't afford it and those that need it the most. What we need in communities like mine across the state, you know, we need those resources. We need that Marshall Plan, if you will, like to reinvent and help build these communities back, because like my community gave so much to the country, actually. You know, it's the birth of the American steel industry, and just like you don't take an 85-year-old person who's lived a life and contributed and paid taxes, and you know, you don't say, well, you're not a value anymore, so out you go. It's like, you know, there are far too many communities that have been that have slid below the basic dignity threshold, and the people that are trapped in those kind of communities have almost effectively no chance of ever escaping from them. And that's very true out in Western Pennsylvania, that's true in coal country, that's true in Chester, that's true in neighborhoods here in Philadelphia. You know, we know how to make a community better by gentrifying it, but that only, as the mayor said, just moves poverty around. And until we address the systemic issues that help bring us to this point, we're just gonna keep building Whole Foods in neighborhoods, making them better, but all they're gonna do is just keep moving people around and not fixing it. So that's why I ran, and that's what keeps me up at night, is what are these communities gonna look like 20 years from now?
Hmm. Yes, ma'am.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, no, we've had collaborations with Carnegie Mellon, and the universities are great. You know, I've invited them to set out like a small satellite campus, you know, if you will, for example, and for those of you that might be remotely familiar with Pittsburgh, everyone in the room has heard of and uses Google, right? Some people may not know Google has the second largest headquarters in Pittsburgh outside of their home office. How did that happen? Does anybody have a guess? Well, it's because of Carnegie Mellon and their software institute. It's the finest in the world, better than MIT, better than Stanford's. It's world renowned. So they set up shop in Pittsburgh. And many of you will probably be taking Uber sometime tonight. Well, guess what? Uber is building their driverless cars in Pittsburgh now. They essentially raided the robotics lab of Carnegie Mellon to do that. Facebook, some of these tech companies, they want to be close to Carnegie Mellon's, you know, School of Software Engineering. Well, where did Carnegie Mellon come from? A guy named Andrew Carnegie. Well, where did Andrew Carnegie make his money to create Carnegie Tech, which became Carnegie Mellon? My community. And let me tell you, my community doesn't look like Google's headquarters, you know, in Pittsburgh. And I'm not suggesting pure parity, but I am suggesting my community shouldn't look the way it does while that one, you know, looks the way it does, because there's a straight line from my community and the mill across the street to Google's high-tech headquarters where they get back rubs and catered lunches every day. You know, there shouldn't be that much disparity. It's never going to be equal, and I understand that. I am never going to make as much money as an executive as Google, and I'm okay with that. But I had that choice. I was given that choice, but there's so many people that never get a chance to choose their own profession, choose their own career, because they don't have the opportunities, you know, in their life, in their community to do so.
Yes, sir.
Disconnect in the older believe about these are the communities where leaders should be speaking up and taking leadership to look at things differently. As you went around the state, Mayor Fetterman, what was your impression of why these towns keep sending people to the Pennsylvania legislature that vote against the very types of resources and concerns that you're speaking out against? They're sending people to the legislature, blocking the very things they need to build the towns that aren't getting the Whole Foods and food.
I mean, there are so many communities across Pennsylvania that have a broken heart.
You know, I heard you speak about you being the first Democrat in your family.
And yeah, yeah.
The first time your family ever voted for
a Democrat. Yeah, they did vote for me, by the way, the first time. Yeah. My dad actually said, is it okay if I give it to Pat Toomey? Will that get you in trouble? Like, no, Dad, you probably don't want to do that. Because I was really the first Democrat that they voted in. And the hyper-partisanship, I mean, in Pennsylvania, a lot of that's rural versus urban, you know? It's like, if I live in Greene County and we have 10,000 people, and, you know, it's like, we have different issues than we have in, say, you know, obviously Philadelphia or an urban district. And does anyone here know what gerrymandering is?
Shh.
Yeah. So, there's a 30 vote.
Every county the size of one congressional district
yeah.
is split into six.
The state house has a 30 vote majority Republican, not because there's more Republicans, but because they, you know, stacked the deck in 2010, and they can tell the Democrats, go sit in that corner, we don't need you, because that their margin is insurmountable, and that's why we didn't get a budget passed all of 2015.
And they created safe districts for themselves.
Yeah, exactly, yeah. And that's the thing. Now, and that's going to change in 2020 when there's the census and the Democrats have control about the Supreme Court, but that doesn't make us any better to get revenge on the Democrats and put them in the corner for the next 10 years. People claim that they went bipartisanship, but they get turned on and energized by the hyper-partisan politics of campaigning and politics. We have conflated politics with governance in this country, much to our detriment. And it's a lot different to score points on Sean Hannity than actually governing and fixing problems and getting potholes filled and creating community. I mean, it's much different, and that's what's lost, and that's why we send the same people back, you know, to these jobs, is because, you know, they know these folks and they espouse the same kind of hot button issues that they agree with, and nobody thinks that, you know, it's very hard to act collectively.
You raise a fascinating issue. It's that what's the matter with Kansas issue, right? That Thomas Frank wrote about people voting against their own economic interests.
It's difficult, right? Because people, I mean, it's very hard to, you know, if you are, I mean, let's look at a lot of state legislatures that have, I know in New Jersey, like our state assembly, for instance, is 2-year terms. And look at the House of Representatives, 2-year terms, right? So if you're in a legislative body and your term is 2 years, there's no time when you're not running for office, right? There's no time when you're not making those fundraising calls. There's no time when you're not in political mode, even while you're supposed to be governing. There's no break. Maybe, I think the joke is you govern for one day, right? I'd be surprised if that was even true. And so you've got people that are, you know, constantly in this political headspace. They've been trained unintentionally to be transactional in the way they deal with people, because they're calling people to raise for money. Oh, you gave me money. Oh, I'm going to talk to you, then you vote for me. I'm going to do this, then you give me money. And that is the dynamic that ends up existing. And that person has to keep running for office. So let's say you've got someone in office and they've identified a really serious challenge with a particular area. So we've got to do this thing here. You know, we've got to vote. You know, we've got to put this into the state budget. And it's going to be really hard, and, you know, we're either going to have to tax you more, or we're going to have to lay these people off, we're going to have to do something that, you know, is going to upset a lot of people. But in the long run, it's going to be what fixes this problem. It's very easy for someone to then step in and say, that guy doesn't know what he's doing. I can fix this without raising taxes, even if that's not true. Right? We have this prisoner's dilemma in the way elections work, that when you're honest, there's always an incentive for someone else to be dishonest, and they can get the upper hand in that election. And that is a huge, huge problem. And I'm not really sure, there's so many different institutional components about why that exists, but there's one aspect of that that I think is actually solvable from our perspective. And it was, you know, my perspective of being in office for one term, not being interested in running for re-election at any point, and knowing, you know, before I got sworn in, I knew when the last day for my job was gonna be as a mayor. And it's very easy to say whatever the hell you want when you aren't running for re-election. And there's a pressure that I could see my colleagues feel that I didn't feel. There's a pressure that I see a lot of other elected, I've worked on dozens of campaigns over the last couple of years, and there is an enormous pressure when you're running for office. And, you know, I've got this just kind of like urge to tell people, like, run for office, do whatever you've got to do to get in there, and then, like, you know, screw it. Like, do what you think is going to be best for your community. Don't worry about those relationships. Don't worry about those partnerships. Don't worry about your future. Worry about your community's future. And it's so much easier to do that. It's so much easier to be selfless when you're not running for re-election. That doesn't mean that you can't be selfless if you're running for re-election. But if we look at the way it tends to go in this country and the kinds of things people have to say, I mean, if you run for office, you get elected, and you've got an election 2 years later, what are you supposed to run on 2 years later? What could you have accomplished in that 30-day, 60-day, 90-day, 6-month, 1-year period of being in a state legislature, for instance? So you have to run on something that isn't really necessarily true. You have to, like, bring on a whole new set of things that you're going to convince people that you're the best at being able to do. The other person can't possibly do it, and you have to believe in me because I represent you and I'm the best person for the job. And you're not running on, here's the data about how we did this thing, here's what was successful, here's what wasn't successful, we made some mistakes and we learned from it, and now we're going to do it better next time. There's no space for that if you're constantly running for re-election. So one of the things I just always have to throw out wherever I am is this idea of running for office in this service framework where you can go in, you say, I'm going to carve out this 2, 3, 4 years, and I'm going to do the job as best I can. And look, if I want to run for office 3 years from now, like, you can go ahead and do that. You can always re-up your service. But to approach being in office in that mindset of not caring about whether the party likes you or not, whether your donors like you or not, just removing each of those in your equation about what decisions you make becomes a lot simpler.
That's really interesting. Yes, Chris.
You said you were with Code for Philly.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I've had the opportunity to work with different brigades in different parts of the country, and I think what hopefully folks here are familiar with what Code for America does, which is basically, and correct me if I don't summarize this the right way, but getting tech talent to help solve civic problems on a volunteer basis. Right. So there's brigades all over the country in different cities and different communities that are working on solving these civic problems. One of the issues, I think, is figuring out ways to get, I mean, even in South Orange, where we're, you know, we've got this, you know, sort of little bustling urban suburb outside of New York City, it was very difficult for us to get the attention of big companies. It was difficult, you know, there's a Code for Newark, there's brigades in other cities in New Jersey, but for a town of 20,000 people, you know, we're not really big enough to be on the radar to do that. And so I think if there's some way to get mayors and council people, elected officials, from different communities collaborating, saying we want to all 5 of these towns go in on this project together, and we're going to attract the attention of this big company that is not going to give some amount of money to some small town, but maybe would give because now these 5 towns add up to a city population size, and being able to rope in a university as part of that. But I think, you know, I don't know, I think that maybe just part of it, you know, one thought, and this is certainly not a solution, but one thought is providing opportunities for people in communities to participate in the governance process, something other than sitting in like 4-hour-long committee meetings that are super boring and very rarely solve problems, and are social clubs in a lot of places of people that, you know, I don't know, go to meetings. And so one of the things we tried to do in South Orange was A, like, cut down the amount of time that we spent in our governing body meetings and create like little working groups of people that would get together, solve a problem, everybody goes home. And like, you're only volunteering on that one small aspect of what the thing is. And maybe that's an opportunity if you're a developer or you're a creative person to provide that, you know, service to the community, and you get your name on that website, and that helps you in your own kind of professional career, and it also helps solve a problem for the community. But I don't know. I think, you know, just one thing is maybe reconfiguring the way that governments get citizens to participate and contribute content, talent, ideas in the governance process to something that's a little bit more mobile, a little bit more remote, and a little bit less like traditionally time intensive.
So we're gonna go, we can go up to the atrium, we can continue this conversation, look at some art, watch some speeches, Chelsea, maybe, but probably not Hillary. And And we want to continue doing these. So let us know, let me know what you thought of this. And I really want to thank these guys because it's easy to get cynical about politics.
You have to be cynical about politics. You have to be aware of your own cynicism. If you lose track of your own cynicism, then you've really kind of lost yourself. Like you can't participate in politics and not be cynical because it's so pervasive. But you just have to be aware of its influence and understand that you want to be able to move past it in ways that are feasible.
Well, also it sounds like the both of you kept at the forefront of your mind, and I think Mayor Warren also, a bigger purpose.
Well, I mean, I would never run in a quixotic campaign. Like, I would never run in a race that I'm not going to Jill Stein it, just trying to make a statement. I would only ever run in a race that I had a chance and I felt like it was going to run. Otherwise, that just continually foments cynicism because it's in my race or locally, I'm happy where I'm at in Braddock. I truly am. I'm a lucky guy. If I can affect change at a greater level through running for a higher office, that's what I did. And if I never get another chance to do it again, hey, I'm still okay with that.
Well, we want to thank you both for your service and your words of wisdom. Thanks again. Thank you. Thanks, man.